It is my distinct pleasure to welcome Guido Roberts-Bersani back to UCSD. Guido is a postdoctoral scholar up at UCLA, but he reminded me about 10 years ago, which makes me feel very old. He was down here as a visiting student while he was at University of Kent, getting the American experience. And of course, California rubbed off on him very well. That's why he's back here again. He got his master's at the University of Kent and then went on to do some post-master's work at ESTEC in Noordwijk and at Leiden University. And then went on to get his PhD at University College London, where I got to meet him again. Things are very different from Brown Dwarfs. He got his PhD in 2019, working with Emily Santong, and Richard Ellis, which is easier to say. I'm working on galaxy evolution over cosmic time, which is going to be an important theme for today's talk. In addition to work on gas flows in and out of galaxies, again, over sort of the evolutionary scale of galaxies, obviously working on the highest redshift galaxies and early galaxy evolution. Guido is actually the PI of one of the Cycle 1 proposals from James Webb to follow up some of these objects with NERSPEC. He's also the recipient of the 2022 UCLA Chancellor's Postdoctoral Research Award. Congratulations on that. Guido's only around in California for a short amount of time because he's going to be going on to an SNSF, which is kind of the equivalent of the sort of European
Horizon.
Right, the Horizons Fellowship. So these kind of very big postdoctoral fellowships are in Europe. This is the Swiss equivalent. He'll be at Geneva starting in June. But we're glad to have him here while he's still here. And he's going to be talking about searching for and characterizing galaxies at cosmic dawn. Let me get the lights so we can see your pretty pictures.
All right. That work? All right, well, first of all, I'd like to thank Adam and the organizers and all of you for having me over here. You know, that experience here at UCSD 10 years ago really did shape, I think, you know, my career today. It had a really big impact on me. So I'm very grateful to everybody here, you know, and UCSD as a whole for giving me that experience. And, you know, today's talk is going to be a kind of, I guess, since then bounced around in terms of different redshifts in galaxy evolution, all from the very local universe to the very, very distant universe. But today's talk really is going to be about the most distant galaxies, or my work on the most distant galaxies forming within the first billion years of the universe. In particular, I hope towards the second half of my talk to highlight some of the first James Webb-related results that came out of our collaboration, the GLASS collaboration, and sort of how that's been impacting our view of early galaxy evolution. So I'll really be focusing on that. But before delving into the James Webb stuff, I think it's important to set the context of what galaxy evolution in the first billion years looked like pre-James Webb. So I'll also be highlighting some of the work that I've been doing over there. So for those who aren't necessarily familiar with galaxy evolution of the first billion years of the universe, I think it's useful to put this into context. This is our, you know, model of the history of the universe, which most of you are familiar with, which started 13.8 billion years ago with the Big Bang. After the Big Bang, we had this rapid period of expansion. We had the fingerprint, let's say, of the Big Bang, the afterglow that was left over in the form of the cosmic microwave background. And only after a few tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of years, we enter a period called the Dark Ages. This is a period of the universe which has a complete absence of UV light. There are no stars, there are no galaxies. It's just neutral hydrogen, and so there's no light from there. But over the first few hundred million years, the very first stars started forming. Those stars formed clusters of stars, and those clusters of stars eventually started forming the very first galaxies. And those first galaxies then started burning through or ionizing the neutral hydrogen that surrounded them. And so hence the epoch of reionization, so-called, began and eventually ended sometime around 1 billion years after the universe formed. And, you know, now we get these beautiful galaxies 13.8 billion years later that have all this lovely structure and live in a transparent universe. And so if we want to understand how we got over here, we really need to understand which sources were the ones that drove this reionization period and how they impacted the universe as we see it today. And so I'll be focusing really galaxies that formed within the first sort of 500 million years, maybe a little bit later, but over this epoch. And so this was sort of, I guess, the pre-JWST state of affairs. You know, galaxies at redshifts greater than 7 are the ones that I'm discussing. And these are the main sort of questions that my research has tried to answer up until now. You know, how prevalent are redshift greater than sources? What were their properties, and did they reionize the universe? And ultimately, what were their star formation histories, and when did they form? Can we pinpoint the timing of so-called cosmic dawn, the timing when the first stars and galaxies formed? And you know, to do that, we really need to find the first galaxies. And this was, again, sort of the state of affairs pre-James Webb. We only had a handful of galaxies either spectroscopically confirmed or candidate galaxies at redshifts greater than 8. And I think it says a lot, actually, that you know, the pace with which this field is transforming, thanks to James Webb, is so rapid. You know, we had a cycle 2 call for proposals only, I think, was it 2 months ago or something? And when I talked to my PI, Tommaso Trey, I said, Tommaso, you know, where should we focus now? Should we look at redshifts beyond 10 or redshift 8 where we can characterize galaxies? And his reply was, we don't, redshift 8 was so 2 months ago. But nonetheless, redshift 8 and above is a very good regime to start. So the first question, how did the first galaxies evolve? Well, HST up until now has been our foremost telescope, our premier flagship telescope. And that's what we've been using in conjunction with Spitzer, for instance, to try and identify very, very distant galaxies. And to do that, we use a technique called the dropout technique. And the reason for this is that spectroscopy is too difficult and very expensive. And so we can do this with the aid of what we call the Lyman break. So at wavelengths blueward effectively of Lyman alpha, it's a rest frame of 1216 angstroms, all the UV light gets absorbed by the intervening neutral hydrogen along the line of sight. So what that means, if I play this again, is that the higher and higher a galaxy is redshifted, that light passes through the photometric bands of HST, and you see that that galaxy drops out of a given filter. And the location of that dropout gives us an approximate location for its redshift. And HST was able, in principle, to look out to redshifts 11, 12 or so. That was really the limit of HST, bar, of course, sensitivity questions and cosmic variance and things like that. And to look for the most distant galaxies with this technique, you really need very, very deep imaging. One of the deepest surveys that we had is the CANDLES HST survey over here that you can see. So there are 5 different areas, if you want, EGS, UDS, Goods North, Goods South, and the Cosmos field as well. So if you want to look for redshift 7 to 9 galaxies, this was kind of illustrating, I think, a little bit of the difficulties where at low redshift, you know, you can find a lot of different galaxies with this technique, but as you go to higher and higher redshifts, particularly at redshifts above 7, the numbers of galaxies start to decrease very rapidly. And this is in part because they're fainter, so it's harder to find, and they're also rarer. And to find galaxies at this redshift regime, redshift 7 and above, right when you're in a very neutral area, so you're in the heart of the reionization epoch, that's why these galaxies are so valuable, you need this band over here, the F105W band, or the Y band. And that is because it's in that band that the galaxy drops out. So the Lyman break from that galaxy drops out in this band. So that's how we get that redshift. The only problem is for our deepest fields, a lot of them in CANDLES, for instance, that Y band is lacking. So the question then arises, well, if we, you know, how do we look for the most distant galaxies in the only data sets where we can really search for them because we have that data? The answer is that Spitzer actually is a very useful tool for that. So what I'm showing you over here is a galaxy SED, a mock spectrum effectively of the galaxy, and the two Spitzer IRAC bands at centered at 3.6 and 4.5 microns. And what you might notice is that within these bands, you have some very strong lines, in particular these lines over here, which are doubly ionized oxygen and hydrogen, so O3 and H beta. And if you were to cycle or shift, let's say redshift, this SED through those bands, you would get a very specific color trend. So what would happen over here at this dip. So you have a color 3.6 minus 4.5, which is effectively zero, becomes a very blue color. And that's because these very strong O3 and H beta lines reside in the 3.6 micron band. So what that's telling you is it's boosting the flux in that band relative to the empty one at 4.5. So you get this blue color. As you go to higher redshifts, redshift 7, that those two lines shift from the 3.6 micron band to the 4.5. And so you start getting a very red color. And that continues all the way out to a redshift of 9.1. So effectively, what we can do now, knowing this, is that the photometric colors are really impacted by physical processes that underlie these galaxies, is we can pre-select galaxies which show a very red Spitzer-Irac color, even in the absence of this Y band. So we can look for redshift 7 to 9 galaxies without this very specific HST band, which otherwise we would have needed for the Lyman break. Now we did this in 2015, and we came up with 4 very distant redshift 7 to 9 galaxies. These at the time were the 4 brightest galaxies known at redshifts greater than 7. And you can see how they appear to drop out in the HST filters. We later got some Y-band data, right, where we would have needed for this dropout technique. And you can see that they drop out over there. And these are their Spitzer postage stamps. And you can sort of see that they're brighter in the 4.5 micron band rather than the 2.6 micron band.
When you say there's no Y-band, is it that the data wasn't taken?
Yes, on that patch of the sky, yeah. So there was a large portion of the candles data set of that sky coverage, which just didn't have imaging in that band. And since it was a significant part of this, you know, of that data set, we looked for an alternative way.
And you went and spoke to the PI who didn't have the Y band.
Yeah, we said, well, come on, step it up. You know. And so in trying to answer the question then of, you know, how prevalent are these galaxies, we can include these galaxies, which were some of the most distant at the time, in a UV luminosity function, which tells us effectively how galaxies evolved, or the number count of galaxies as a function of their intrinsic UV magnitude. And this really helps constrain at the very brightest end over here, how, you know, these galaxies evolved and whether they have somewhat of a shallow evolution or whether they have a steeper evolution. And this gives you constraints on the type of feedback, for instance, that you get at the time, whether supermassive black holes already existed at redshift 6 and above, whether they didn't, whether stellar feedback and galactic feedback played a big role in suppressing galaxies. So this is extremely valuable because these sources are very rare, effectively. And so you need them to constrain this part of the diagram to distinguish between galaxy evolution models. So this was a little bit of work that we did in 2016 to try and address this. The next question is, James Webb effectively then is needed to probe galaxies that are further and further out to fill this space over here where you start going to redshifts 10 or so. We start getting to the limits of where Hubble and Spitzer can probe. So we really, we need James Webb for that. The second question then is, what are their underlying properties? And these galaxies that are redshift 7 to 9, they reside in the reionization epoch. Did they reionize the universe? At the time, you know, we would go out then with the VLT and with Keck. We follow up these galaxies, which I'm showing you again over here, trying to look for Lyman alpha. Lyman alpha is that signature of UV light, which if you don't see, you assume is due to the intergalactic medium that is absorbing that light. If you do see it, suggests that those galaxies carved out an ionized bubble. And we went and followed up each of these galaxies. And curiously enough, we got 100% confirmation rate. Every single one of these galaxies showed Lyman alpha. Now, this was really, really surprising because you don't expect to see that. What I'm showing you over here is the fraction of Lyman alpha emitters on the y-axis as a function of redshift. And what you'll notice is there's almost this sort of triangular direction, if you want, where over here you see the number of Lyman alpha emitters from 4 to 6 is increasing. And that's because galaxies, as you go to higher and higher redshifts, are younger. They have less dust. So you have less dust that is obscuring the Lyman alpha. But then once you get to redshifts of 6 or so, you start seeing a decline. And that is because your universe is filling up with neutral hydrogen that blocks the Lyman alpha again. So it's really curious to see why all of these galaxies showed prominent Lyman alpha emission in a significantly neutral era. So these are very bright galaxies, and the question then arose of, you know, do they show Lyman Alpha because they're heavily clustered galaxies? Massive galaxies tend to reside in overdensities, so you might be surrounded then by, you know, smaller and smaller galaxies that surround them, and the collective ionizing output of those galaxies is able to blow out a larger ionized bubble. And so we sort of wanted to distinguish between these two scenarios. So we went and targeted fainter galaxies, UV fainter galaxies, which are less subject to clustering effects. So we went and we had six nights with Keck, with MOSFIRE, looking at five different galaxies. We had three nights on each of these galaxies. They're selected in identical fashion to those bright galaxies. The only difference is that they are fainter. We went and followed them up with Keck MOSFIRE again and found only very, very marginal Lyman alpha, which I'm not showing in detail over here, in two of these galaxies. So we've gone from 100% detection rate all the way down to, I think it was 40% modulo the error bar, something like that. So it's clear then that these UV bright galaxies are very special. There's something curious about them if they are systematically able to ionize large bubbles in a significantly neutral era. And these could then be galaxies that perhaps started the reionization process by maybe starting, you know, having some very strong power source to blow out an ionized bubble. And then maybe reionization continued with the UV faint galaxies, which are more prevalent, and reionized the rest of the universe. So we're not sure, you know, really what's going on over here, but it's clear that the intrinsic UV magnitude of the galaxy plays a role.
Any evidence for quasar or radio like that?
Yes. Well, there's evidence for AGN. Yes. And that's actually a plot I should have included at some point, but that's something James Webb has now started unveiling. We actually got some tantalizing evidence for that beforehand. So there's some curiosities related to these galaxies. One is, of course, that they show very high Lyman alpha detection rates. And in other galaxies that are selected in identical fashion, so they show this so-called Spitzer-Irac excess. You know, we also see very hard radiation fields from ionized carbon emission. We see evidence for dust continuum measurements from ALMA. We also see evidence for AGN activity based on line ratios that we look at, rest frame UV lines, higher stellar masses and metallicities, and ultimately also some evidence of disk rotation. So all of this is pointing towards the fact that maybe these very UV bright galaxies show more evolved properties compared to their UV faint counterparts. And perhaps this is one reason why they are able to start this sort of early reionization. But ultimately we really need James Webb's spectroscopy, which covers a much larger range in wavelength and is also a lot more sensitive, to look not just at Lyman alpha, but also the entirety of the rest frame optical of these galaxies, which so far we're only able really to measure with Spitzer photometry. So that's where James Webb will come into play again. The third question of my research is, okay, we have these distant galaxies, but are they the first generations of galaxies, the first ones to form? And if not, how can we pinpoint when they formed? When did the first stars form? So over here, I'm showing you one of those UV bright galaxies. You can see again, this Spitzer-Irac excess, this boosting of this 4.5 micron band due to very strong O3 and H beta lines, which come from very, very young stars. So one would presume that these galaxies are very, very young galaxies that maybe have a lifetime of only a couple of 100 million years or so. But actually, if you look at the 4,000 rest frame angstrom location of the spectrum, you see what's called the Balmer break. This Balmer break over here is due to absorption of metals in the atmospheres of stars. And you can see that as stars get older and older, from 20 mega years over here all the way down to 500, this break becomes larger and larger. And so this is from mature stars. And if you were to overplot the Spitzer HST photometry, it looks remarkably similar, actually. Right. So we had, so if I point you back to that Spitzer-Irac color diagram, which I showed you a little bit while back, at a redshift of 9.1, those strong lines fall out of the Spitzer band. So whatever excess there may be cannot be due to strong lines. we found, we decided to follow up this redshift 9 approximately galaxy, which is strongly amplified, found in the clash frontier fields with Spitzer and HST. And we targeted it with spectroscopy from ALMA and also the VLT. And we found both a line of oxygen 3 as well as Lyman alpha in this galaxy. And what that allowed us to do was to pinpoint the precise redshift of the galaxy, which was at 9.11. And that means that the excess, the Spitzer IRAC excess coming from this galaxy, you can see here clearly it's much brighter in the second IRAC band compared to the first one, meant that its IRAC excess could not be due to young stars, but actually, if you start modeling it, had to be due to more mature stars that formed, you know, more than 100 mega years prior to when we see it. So that effectively tells us that this galaxy formed at redshifts greater than 12 or so. It's no longer a young galaxy. So the question then arises, well, with all these Spitzer IRAC or these IRAC excess galaxies that we see at low redshift, are we still comfortable with the notion that they might be young galaxies? Maybe they have more mature stars and we can rewind the clock to see when they formed. So what I'm plotting over here is two SEVs. In red, you have a Balmer Break galaxy from the one I showed you just before. And in blue, you have the young galaxy SED, which I also showed before from the same galaxy, and the Spitzer IRAC bands. And if you were to shift these two SEVs through these two bands as a function of redshift, you would get this plot, which I'll show you. And every single point over here is a spectroscopically confirmed galaxy. And so this is sort of what you would get for the young galaxy. You can see it reproduces this color trends, which we exploited before. But for the more mature galaxy, it's much more of a smoother sort of evolution. And crucially, you can see that at redshifts, maybe 8.5 and higher or so, there's clearly space for a degeneracy, where these galaxies that we presume young, you know, some of these, for instance, could actually be galaxies with more mature stars. Just to make sure it's independent of our models, we take some models that are both very young and very old. We put them through the same exercise, and you can see the young models, again, reproduce this same trend that we expect from O3 plus H-beta lines, and the darker the model, the larger the stellar age, and you can see it's very similar to the red curve. So what we decided to do then was to follow up every single spectroscopically confirmed galaxy at redshifts greater than 7, for which there could be this degeneracy, but that had constraints from ALMA. And the reason is that ALMA is able to target emission of O3 emission, which we presume comes from young stars. It's the same species as the O3 emission that we see in the Spitzer IRAC band. So the idea is if you can place constraints on the emission there, you get indirect constraints at the rest frame optical. Furthermore, ALMA can also observe continuum emission, which is primarily due to dust in these galaxies. So if we assume that the dust perhaps comes from the more mature stellar populations, that serves as an added constraint. So this is a nice spectroscopically confirmed galaxy, which I think showcases the point quite well. You see the galaxy SED. In red, you have the HST. In red, you have the Spitzer photometry, where you see this excess again. And on the right, you see the ALMA constraint. So O3 detection for this galaxy, as well as dust detection. And if you were to model the photometry of this galaxy ignoring ALMA, you get the blue points on the main plot, which is you're able to very easily reproduce the young stars that give rise to this strong emission. However, if you include the ALMA data over here, all of a sudden you can no longer reproduce the so-called IRAC excess. So that suggests that you need a secondary component to boost the flux in the 4.5 micron band, in essence, a Balmer break from mature stars. So we did this modeling for 4 galaxies. I'm only showing 3 of them here, but for 4 galaxies that had this data, you can see the HST and Spitzer data in the left plots, and then on the right, the ALMA constraints. And almost every single one of them favored a situation where you had more mature stars. And you can see that their ages increase from, you know, just a few mega years to all of a sudden hundreds of mega years, you know, 100 plus. Bar 1, which increases by, you know, a factor of 10 more or less. But this is really important because, you know, if a lot of these galaxies formed earlier than we expected, then their stellar masses increase as well. And in this case, by an average factor of 30 or so. And that really has important implications for when galaxies form. So if you, you know, I mentioned this sort of key redshift of a redshift of 9.11, beyond which you cannot be contaminated by these lines. So we conducted another spectroscopic campaign for all the galaxies that had a photometric redshift greater than 9 or so. We used the VLT, ALMA, Gemini, and Keck to follow them up. These are all galaxies for which they had a suspected Balmer break. And we confirmed a large amount of them, I can't remember the exact fraction, I think it was 5 out of 6, that favored a Balmer break, so favored more mature stars again. And if you were to trace back their star formation histories, that's what the plot that I'm showing on the right, it's their intrinsic UV magnitude on the y-axis as a function of redshift. You can see that they formed at redshifts greater than 12, and slowly as the universe is evolving, basically, they become brighter and brighter. And crucially, what you can see from the gray shaded regions, these are the depths that will be reached for a variety of filters with James Webb. So curiously, James Webb is going to be able then to pick up the progenitors of these Balmer break galaxies. So to place all of this in a little bit of context, really what this is saying is, you know, when did cosmic dawn occur? This is the cosmic star formation rate density of the universe as a function of redshift. And, you know, there's been a little bit of debate in the literature up until now about whether the evolution of these galaxies follows the evolution of their dark matter halos, or whether it tails off at redshifts of 9, 10 or so, and starts following this gray regime over here. And that's important because that'll tell you when cosmic dawn occurred, when the first stars and galaxies occurred. And if we take the average star formation history of all of these Balmer break galaxies, which I mentioned to you before, for which we model their star formation histories with the HST and Spitzer photometry, you can get their average star formation histories, which tells you that up to 40, nearly 70% of their stellar mass could already be in place by a redshift of 10 or so. So that suggests star formation began a lot earlier than what had previously been assumed. But ultimately, we really need JWST imaging and spectroscopy to verify any of this. And thankfully, you know, Christmas 2 years ago, I think it was the best Christmas anyone's had in a little while. I was very fortunate to be there in the control room to watch this launch. This is a quick video that I took. I don't know if you can hear the sound. It's actually going to launch from, so I was, you know, randomly looking sort of all over the place, but all of a sudden you get this beautiful ball of fire, really, that takes off and clears the first stages of the clouds. And once it's cleared the first stages, you might not be able to see it anymore, but you certainly hear it, and you can feel the rumble. It's quite an experience, really. So I was very pleased to be over there. So this is where I start delving into the James Webb work that I've been involved in trying to answer the more conclusively the questions which I've been trying to answer up until now. This is primarily through the GLASS program. GLASS is led by my PI, Tommaso Treu at UCLA. This is a small number of the collaborators that we have. And GLASS is one of the so-called early release science observations. So they're some of the first observations to come out from the James Webb Space Telescope. It's the deepest of the extragalactic ERS surveys. It effectively makes use of nature's magnifying glass. So gravitational lensing, which I'm sure all of you are familiar with, and targets the Abel 2744 galaxy cluster. This is because this cluster has been studied really extensively with HST and has a large plethora, really, of galaxy types, of galaxy redshifts. You know, it has galaxies from redshift 0, cluster galaxies, all the way out to redshifts of 10 or so that are both lensed or a little further out, you know, minor lensed, basically. And so we have three different modes. We observe this cluster with the nearest and near spectroscopic instruments on James Webb. And in parallel, we take near-cam imaging in 7 different bands. So NIRIS provides us with a wide-field slitless spectrograph, which basically means we get effectively 1 to 2.2 micron spectrum for every single galaxy within that field of view. Simultaneously, we have 7 wideband filters with NIRCam in an effectively blank field that's offset from the center. And then we also make use of NIRSpec spectroscopy over 3 different gratings, which give us effectively 0.6 to 5.3 micron spectra with very high resolution, R of 2700. And that is a unique feature of our ERS survey. And together with that, we also make use of a DDT, a directed discretionary time program, using prism spectroscopy with NIRSpec for several of the sources over here. So James Webb now has the power really to extend what Hubble has done and go, you know, far beyond that. And I think this is, you know, we've had a lot of spectacular images that have come out over the last months, but I think this is probably my favorite so far. This is called Pandora's cluster. Over here, you have the AGOL 2744 cluster that we study, but you know, it's really a stunning image. It shows that the part of the cluster we target is effectively part of a much larger cluster over here. And just, you know, the variety of galaxies here, I think is absolutely stunning. I could look at this.
Quite heavy lens on that.
That's right. Yeah. So a lot of these are very heavily lensed.
Like that.
Exactly. Yeah. So I don't know if you can make out all of the lens caustics, all the lens galaxies, sorry, for here, but there's some evidence for some over here. And over here, for instance, over here is some. So it really is a beautiful image. This is part of this more extended image is part of the Uncover survey, which is a cycle one program. But over the first months, so we set out then to, you know, answer the first question, how prevalent are distant galaxies? And we conducted a search for very, very distant galaxies using now the novel filter sets that we had with NIRCam. And we came up with 7 different galaxies over here, which are supposed to be at redshifts between 10 to 12, you know, so that are seen only 500 million years after the Big Bang. These are scattered all across the image over here. This was a second paper led by Marco Castellano. His first paper, he'd identified 2 of these galaxies prior to the extended data set coming out. And these are 2 of the most distant galaxies found so far. And they're also 2 of the most robust ones. These 2 galaxies are picked out by every single study that has been conducted afterwards. You can see a very clear dropout nature in the postage stamps over here. And crucially, this one, for instance, would have been completely missed by HST. HST's limit is effectively here. So you just would not have seen it. And the fact that we find 7 within this area already is pretty special. Now, we were not the only ones, of course, looking for very distant galaxies. Another survey, the SEERS team started looking for distant galaxies. For instance, in the CANDLES EGS field, they came up with this galaxy candidate at a redshift of 11 or so. This is been called since Maisie's galaxy, which is another very robust one. And this curious galaxy over here, which was suggested to be at a redshift of 16.6. So we've never seen this before, effectively. So all of this is suggesting that early galaxies might be a lot more prevalent than we thought, especially these UV bright ones.
Are you all right in the area that's heavily lensed?
No, sorry. So the ones which I showed before here are. But these ones are in a blank field. So we're seeing it both in lensed areas and in unlensed areas. And so, you know, the question arises, well, why did we not see them beforehand? Does this change our understanding of early galaxy evolution? And well, we didn't see them partly because of the limited wavelength coverage of HST, but also due to its sensitivity. And ultimately, if we plot these new results in the points, this is a nice plot by Charlotte Mason et al., who compare a variety of luminosity functions to the points over here. These sort of light shaded lines basically arise when you ramp up the star formation efficiency to 100%, which is unheard of. These are effectively nearly unphysical, if you want. Or these stronger lines where the dashed line basically follows the galaxy to dark matter halo relation. So it suggests that the efficiency of star formation is correlated to that, but you assume no dust, or the solid lines where you assume some level of dust as well. And you can see the error bars are very, very large, but ultimately this scenario can be explained, this abundance of galaxies, of early galaxies can be explained if you assume that there's very little to no dust in the very early universe. All of these galaxies, however, are photometric galaxies. They need to be spectroscopically verified. I really like this plot actually, because it's the redshift record for GRVs, galaxies, and quasars as a function of year. And you can see really that in the early years, you seem to have a new redshift record almost every year or so. But over the last decade, that has really stagnated. And you know, now we have either a giant leap or you know, not a lot of evolution. And this is for a variety of reasons, but primarily due to the fact that we have very limited, well, we have an atmosphere, first of all, of course. But we also have very limited number of tracers with which we can confirm the distances to these galaxies. We either have Lyman alpha, which I showed you, which is attenuated by the intergalactic medium, so we don't expect to see that. We either have oxygen 3, for instance, that we can see with ALMA, but that depends on the underlying galaxy physics. So we don't know beforehand whether we're going to see it or not. Or we can do it via measuring the Lyman break, but that is extremely difficult purely on sensitivity grounds. So these are sort of the limiting factors. And I think this very nice plot by Richard Bowens really sort of describes the pre-JWST era. And you can see, so all of these points that have some fill or dark shaded border have been spectroscopically confirmed, either with sort of O3 and carbon, for instance, with ALMA in red, or via Lyman alpha in blue. And again, you can see this very, very sharp decrease in the number of detections, and they are exclusive to the most luminous sources. So in trying to address that, we can use GLASS. I mentioned that we had NIRIS observations for this galaxy cluster. And so we went out to see whether we could confirm any of these galaxies independently of any of these emission line traces. And we found, these are the three different filters for which we have the spectra. And we found two. So these galaxies that I'm showing in the top left of the false color image is a candidate protocluster at redshift 8. So it is clustering of lens galaxies that are thought to reside so close together, they will eventually develop into one of these giant clusters. And you can see that these two galaxies show a very clear Lyman break at an observed wavelength of 1.1 microns or so, just blue, which places them at redshifts of 8. So in perfect agreement with their photometric redshifts. And you can see their continuum redward of that. And crucially, what you might observe here is that there's no Lyman alpha. So we're picking up galaxies for the first time. We're confirming their redshifts independently of their underlying physics, effectively. We're picking them up purely on the effects of the IGM. So we're getting unbiased confirmations of galaxies. So this was one of the first results that we put out. I mentioned we also had near-spec coverage of the cluster. So this is the extended galaxy cluster, Pandora's cluster. This was, for those on Zoom, the central part is what we'd observe with GLASS. And this is the footprint of near-spec. And so within each of these quadrants, we can effectively, it's basically Keck MOSFIR on steroids, let's say. You can effectively place hundreds of galaxies in each of these quadrants and open small shutters to get a 0.6 to 5.3 micron spectrum. In green, I'm highlighting the constraints that we had for the target selection. So it was really motivated by the protocluster of redshift 8 galaxies, some confirmed galaxies at redshifts 1 to 3, either with NEWS or HST, and some star clusters as well. And for the DDT that we had, because we could not target the central regions of the galaxy cluster due to the constraints that we had on the position angle and the high redshift sources, we shifted the second pointing slightly more towards the center and followed galaxies up over there. So these are those protocluster galaxies that I mentioned. There are 7 of them, all touted to be at redshift of 8 or so. And we followed each of them up, and we got 100% success rate with these galaxies, confirming each of them either through, I'm just showing two examples over here, confirming each of them with the alignment break and through the presence of strong O3 plus H beta lines, those famous lines that I was describing with Spitzer. And you can see those lines in the bottom right plot of each of these and the alignment break on the left side. I mentioned that we have very high resolution data. We also have R of 100 to 300 data, and that is the difference between the top and the bottom plots over here. And so for the very first time now with these redshifts, we can demagnify or trace back, let's say, the galaxies and find that these are all galaxies that reside in a very compact radius of about 60 kiloparsecs or so. We can place some estimates for the very first time on the velocity dispersion of this protocluster under certain assumptions found to be just over 1,000 kilometers per second. And we can place some lower limits on the halo mass of these galaxies as well. I say lower limits because there are probably some other galaxies that are part of this protocluster, which we have not confirmed, find it to be about of order 4 times 10 to the 11 solar masses. So this is some of the physics that we can do for the very first time. We can also do some result studies of these galaxies finally. This is one of those very distant galaxies that I mentioned at the start, those seven galaxies at redshift 9, 10, and above. And we managed to confirm it with the GLASS data, three different gratings over here. You can see the Lyman break on the left. On the top, you have the near-cam postage stamps of this galaxy. And this galaxy is the brightest one that we know of to date. And with because of the very high sensitivity and the resolution of our data set, we can pick up all of these different lines and start inferring, you know, more accurate properties such as their metallicities, their ages, their dust and star formation quantities, all of these sort of things. So this is a galaxy that we confirmed at a redshift of 9.3. And like I said, it is the brightest galaxy that we have to date. And one thing that I think is really neat as well is what you might notice from these two images is this galaxy is not just some singular compact point. It's in fact, most likely a merging galaxy over here. It has multiple components. And so for the first time, because the data is deep enough, we can start doing resolved studies with imaging of this galaxy. And that's what I'm showing in the bottom panels over here. You can start doing resolved studies of the stellar mass, surface density, of the star formation rate, surface density, of their dust content, of their ages, for instance. And this suggests, if you look, for instance, at the second panel, that this galaxy is formed almost of two clumps, one which seems to be a much younger component in the order of just a few 10 mega years, and one which has an age of just over 100 mega years. So that really has implications then for integrated studies of galaxies and also for UV luminosity functions, where previously we might have assumed that this was just a single galaxy.
For those two, are they both clumps of the same redshift?
Yes, I believe the near spec slit covers both, yeah. So that is at the brightest end, but because we're dealing with gravitational lensing, that allows us to peer fainter and fainter than ever before. Without gravitational lensing, you know, even with James Webb, we would only really be able to target the brightest sources, but we can now go to the faintest sources. And this was a gravitationally lensed and triply imaged source identified by Eddie Zittrain et al. With HST at a redshift of 10 or so. Right. And so you can see here the postage stamp, it drops out in the filters we expect. These are all near cam data. You can see the resolution is really fantastic, especially at wavelengths greater than 3 microns, where prior to that we only had Spitzer. And we can do a quick photo Z analysis to determine the best fit photometric redshift of this galaxy, which is at redshift 9.7 or so. And we got time to go follow this up. And this was the spectrum that we got. So you can see it doesn't necessarily look spectacular in some ways, but really this is the faintest galaxy, intrinsically faintest galaxy that we have observed to date in the early universe. And you can see that the photometry, which is plotted over the spectrum in purple, is perfectly matched. They're perfectly matched between themselves. And if you zoom in and bin the data, you can see that there really is this Lyman break, this sharp drop in the flux due to the intergalactic medium, which places this galaxy perfectly at its photometric redshift of 9.8. And so with that spectroscopic redshift in mind, we can characterize its properties. And one thing which I think is really neat is we can, with its magnification factor, which is on the order of 13 or so, we can effectively reconstruct the galaxy in its source plane again. So we can retrace the light rays to find that effectively this is a very compact source. And you might have noticed again, there are no emission lines like Lyman Alpha. So none of these galaxies, which I showed you before, are have created a large ionized bubble. So they are much more representative. And crucially, this galaxy is much more representative of the faint sources that might have driven the reionization process. And you know, keep in mind, this spectrum was in 73 minutes of observations. The sources that I showed you at the start, those IRAC excess sources, that was three nights with Keck where we didn't see anything. This was 73 minutes with NIRSpec. I think that's really phenomenal.
And did I see the metallicity was 0.2 or something like that?
So I think there's a little bit of discrepancy with the metallicity because as you see, there are several different components of this galaxy, which is only revealed by NIRCam. And so the spectroscopy only traces one part of those, whilst the photometry is that integrated galaxy. So resolved studies of the galaxy is what we would like to do next. So again, this sort of places into context with GLASS, we're able to probe the brightest end of the luminosity function. That's a cyan point at the top there, and also the faintest end of the UV luminosity function with JD1. That's the orange star at the bottom there. And again, this is really important because the brightest sources are needed to constrain the slope of the UV luminosity function to distinguish between galaxy evolution models. But then these very, very faint sources are needed to constrain the role of galaxies in reionizing the galaxies. So I think I'm nearly out of time, but there's still a couple of results left. Those two galaxies that I showed you beforehand, we recently got spectra for those. The one on the left is confirmed at 11.4 or so. So it is one of the most distant galaxies that we know of, whilst this crazy redshift 16.6 galaxy actually turned out to be a redshift 5 interloper. So, you know, a little bit of, we need a little bit of caution before we start saying the universe is broken. And at this point, well, my battery's about to die, sorry. At this point, I'd like to advertise quickly my own Cycle 1 program. Every single one of these galaxies that I've shown you have come from a very small patch of the sky. So how do we know that they are representative of the general galaxy population? We don't. So one thing that we did was we conducted the largest space-based search with HST in pure parallel mode. So what that means is whilst HST is observing some patch of the sky, we piggyback off of that program and observe. So we don't know beforehand where we're going to observe, and our data is shallower, but it does mean that we're able to probe lots of different pointings across the entirety of the sky. And we came up with something like 50 sources at redshift 7 to 9 or so. And my own program, thankfully, Space Telescope allowed me to observe for 25 hours, more or less, with NIRSpec over 10 of these redshift 7 to 9 sources to get the entire rest frame UV and majority of the rest frame optical spectrum at greater than 5 sigma per pixel to try and get representative measurements of these 10 different galaxies. And we're combining with another set of observations, which are virtually identical observations to effectively get an entire sample of, I think it was 22 galaxies. Half of these will have constraints with ALMA also to look at the dust, for instance, and the neutral gas. And you know, this was one spectrum that came through very recently. This is literally on the order of weeks. And you can see this beautiful Lyman break, which confirms it at an redshift of 8.3. Oxygen lines over here on the right for those on Zoom. Oxygen, strong O3 and H beta lines, as well as more moderate O2 lines. So this is kind of an example of what we'll be getting with this program. And now we can start looking at, for instance, Lyman alpha detections in representative galaxies across the entire area of the sky. So I'll finish there, also because my laptop's going to die. Sorry, but basically, with James Webb, we've been able to confirm every single redshift greater than 7 source that we set out to look for. With NIRCam, we were able to find a lot of redshift greater than 10 galaxies already within the Abel 2744 cluster, which matches really the predictions that we had with Spitzer and IRAC, that galaxies formed most likely at maybe redshifts of 12 and beyond or so. That you know, there was a significant contribution to the cosmic star formation rate density of the universe beyond the redshift of 10. With nearest and near spec, we're able to finally get redshifts and properties of galaxies independently of Lyman alpha. First generations of galaxies will still have to wait. I think we don't have any confirmed redshift 16 galaxies, but I think once more data comes in, we'll be able to pinpoint a little bit more accurately when the first stars form and when the first galaxies form. So I'll leave it there. Thank you so much.
Questions for Guido?
Yeah.
Does the UV from AGN affect any of these things, the measurements you make?
Yeah, so if they have AGN, then certainly. So I haven't shown any necessarily over here because I have not been involved with them at that point. But one of the galaxies, for instance, that I had shown, one of those four ones, the highest redshift one, is in fact most likely an AGN. And you can see it through the near spec spectrum, both in the UV, in the rest frame UV lines, et cetera. And then some of these galaxies that have been suggested to be at redshift 7 to 9 and above are now confirmed actually to be maybe redshift 5 AGN. So certainly there are AGN contributions. And I think one of the key driving points right now is to distinguish which galaxies at high redshift are AGN or which ones are star forming galaxies.
Yeah.
Is there tension with the theorists on having these early galaxies moving cosmic dawn to 12 or something like that?
I don't think so, not necessarily. The controversy up until now has really come with their stellar masses rather than the redshifts itself. There hasn't been a tension with the redshifts, especially because the constraints that we had with HST, et cetera, were quite loose. So the tension with the stellar masses has come from some studies suggesting that some of these galaxies at redshift 7 to 9 have stellar masses beyond redshifts 10 to the 10, 10 to the 11, even, something like that. That would be intention, but since publication of those, the spectra that have come in have shown that they're actually not even at the redshifts suggested, they're at redshift 5 and they are AGN. So those results are just wrong. They're not right. So at the moment, there's no tension.
Thank you.
Other questions? Take care. A question. So the picture you showed at the beginning of the formation of these kind of Lyman alpha bubbles, the reionization bubbles. So I always see these as kind of these, you know, perfect Strombson spheres, but is there any, you know, fluid flow or, you know, flow out of the galaxies themselves that would create, make more complex structures around these where the neutral gas, you know, might even for along some of the big sources might actually still have patches of sort of neutral gas because it's just flowing in a particular way. Is there anything been said about kind of the spatial distribution of that material around the galaxies?
Yes. So we actually, so along those lines, we actually put out a paper last month where we followed up every single one of the confirmed galaxies with Lyman alpha that now had NIRCam observations. And we saw that every single one that had Lyman alpha was in fact a merger. Mm. And so what was happening there when we compared to simulations was that these mergers were disrupting the gas, the neutral gas within the galaxies and the dust to effectively create pockets, if you want, where this Lyman alpha could leak out. Mm. So in that sense, yes. In terms of the rest of the environment, that's not something we've looked at.
So you're looking at kind of very bright and very dim star formation, and you're not finding any alignment up and down here, but you're finding up here.
That's right.
I mean, is there somewhere in the middle where these effects might start to play a role and you can say something about, you know, beyond just sort of the photon ionization?
I think it's both. I think environment will play a role at both levels. But I think from what we've looked at anyways, it's pretty clear that these ultra UV bright ones are intrinsically odd as well. Just because they're intrinsically odd does not mean that there aren't environmental effects. I suspect there are, but even with environmental effects, we can't explain the detection rate of the very, very bright ones. Maybe AGN, one of them actually has been confirmed as an AGN, and that is the top one over here, 8.6, now with near spec. That spectrum I haven't shown. Yeah.
Yeah.
So you mentioned accounting for dust. How much dust are we talking here?
That's a good question. I can't remember off the top of my head. I have to look at the paper again, but it's usually with very, very simplistic assumptions. We don't have the constraints of high redshift to put accurate constraints on dust, just because we don't have those constraints. So the contribution of dust is very loose, let's say. That's not something I would want to bet on in terms of getting an accurate number. So sorry, I can't answer that specifically. Sorry?
But there is dust in some way.
Yeah, we think so, just because we see it with the continuum, because we have the redshifts, we know which part of the continuum we're observing with ALMA. And we know that it's got to be continuum that comes from heating by dust. So, sorry about that.
No, Zoom's still on.
Zoom's still on, okay. Yeah, so we don't know more than that.
Awesome. A very quick question. Do you see any evidence for outflows? Are there any asymmetries in your emission?
So that's not something we've looked at as part of GLASS just yet, but people have started looking at that, and they do see broad emission, particularly in H alpha. At recent conferences that I've been to, the argument has been because the broad regions are in H alpha and not in other lines, that suggests AGN rather than outflows. But even at, you know, at those redshifts now, the signal to noise is low enough that you could have some degeneracy. So that's something to look out for sure. There's evidence, at least, let's say.
Any other questions? Okay, well, let's give Guido a round of applause. So Brad didn't stick around, and we'll have Brad's company for about 15 minutes, and then we'll come and get Brad for lunch.
Okay, sounds good. Yeah.
Thanks, everyone online.
Thank you.